Welcome to the power of communication. We warmly welcome Saneia Norton, who is a fabulous mentor of mine, but also is really across different practitioners and how we can better use communication. And a few years ago, Saneia did a workshop when I was at Aspect Studios, and it was incredibly interesting because it was the first time that we as a group had sort of stopped and actually reflected on how we present and the meaning that that puts into the actual work that we are presenting. So really wanted to emphasize the importance of learning this as students, you know, getting ahead and learning some great tips that would take you into your profession, take you into interviews with more confidence, but also with your presentations coming up, hopefully gives you a really valuable set of tips about how you can structure those presentations to do the work justice. So Saneia has run multiple workshops and masterclasses. She's been very involved with AILA and has run various Latitude events. So welcome, Saneia, and thank you so much for your time and for your incredible organisation to make today a really valuable, engaging workshop. Thank you.
Thank you, Saneia.
Thanks so much. It's really great to be here. It's nice to see you all. Let me just get my tech sorted. Can everybody see my screen?
Yeah.
Everybody hear me okay, hopefully? So as Emma said, I'm a landscape architect. And after 20 years in the industry, I started coaching landscape architects, architects and urban designers to become stronger communicators. Why? Because I noticed a problem. We're ideas communicators and we're focused on visuals. And that's great. It's super important. We've become really, really good at the visuals and we spend most of our time thinking about how we communicate in that way. But I find that our verbal communication, and that means how we write, how we speak about our work, it doesn't have the same attention. And in practice, you know, the confident types or people who are maybe naturally more verbal, more articulate, more outgoing even, those types of people get more opportunities to present to clients and to improve that skill. Whereas many other creative types who are great at the visuals, maybe a bit more nervous, maybe a bit more introverted, they don't get the support that they need to grow those skills and then, you know, further themselves in the profession. What I'm going to offer you today are some really practical tools and tips to help you pull everything together. So I'm aware that you're close to the end of your subject, of your studio. I know that many of you may be feeling maybe a bit overwhelmed, maybe a bit stressed, and also that your projects, your actual projects that you've worked so hard on will be consuming a lot of your headspace. So what I'm keen to do today is to offer you a few tips to pull all that together and think about how to communicate that to somebody else. In the short term, how to do a great presentation to your tutors, to your lecturers, for your end of year reviews. But also in the long term, there's some tips in here for you as you move into practice. And even as you prepare for any type of meeting or presentation, you can use these same skills. So in the long term, how to be more open, more collaborative, more clear, and persuasive, and build confidence in your own communication style. So on that, I'm not going to comment too much on visual representation. I'm going to focus more on three things. Content, and that by that I mean words. I mean the words that we put together to talk about our work. Structure, and that means how you order information in a short space of time to get your key points across. And then delivery. So how do you actually say it? What is your body language? What does your face do? What does your voice do to work the nonverbal and the verbal to make sure all modes of communication are supporting your key message? We're going to do a workshop session after the lecture where you can put some of these principles into practice and we can give each other some feedback and you can use the time to generate some of this content for your verbal presentation. There's a fair bit of information in this lecture. So I've put together some worksheets that has basically all the information in it. Emma's uploaded them for you, and you can refer to them at any time to do these exercises later. I'm also really keen for you to put questions into chat. Do we have a chat function going, Emma, at the moment? We do, great. So I've divided this lecture into three sections, and at the end of each section, there'll be a moment where you might be able to, might have a few questions, put them into the chat and we can address them as we go along at the end of those three sections. Plus we'll have time in the workshop to answer any more questions that you have. Okay. Is that second slide shown? Great. I like to think of this image as you are here. So imagine showing this picture to anybody who's not in an architecture degree. And I think they would agree that it's fairly terrifying. You know, there's one person, maybe a couple of people standing up the front. You've got your work, you've got your model, your project. And there's a row of people sitting in front of you with their arms crossed, about to critique, about to judge. And then behind them are all your peers. This is a public critique. And it's something that we've had to become used to in architecture, in landscape architecture, a design degree, and develop specific skills for. That's part of what today's about. Unfortunately, in the past, a lot of students have navigated this, you know, slightly scary situation by trial and error. And again, confident types, people that are able to put on a little bit of a show, they do fine, you know, they do fairly well. While this type of situation, a review or a jury, design jury situation, has put others that I know, colleagues, and people who have actually left the profession, it's put them off the profession for life. People have been scarred by some of these experiences. So I'm making the point that it's not easy. This type of situation requires preparation and it takes practice. And the other thing that it is it's actually really good preparation for the profession, because we don't design in a vacuum. We need people to realize ideas, to work with, to pay us, to make work for us, to live in our work. We're designing for people. And so we need to listen to what they think. We need to ideally involve them. So it's normal to feel nervous when you're faced with this type of situation. I got a perspective from a dean of UNSW, Helen Lockhead, and I asked her, when she's sitting in the front of a, you know, a room like that, sitting in front of a student presenting, what does she want to know? And she said, the first thing I want to know is the overarching narrative. What is your big idea? What are you trying to achieve here? Why are you doing what you're doing and not something else? What is your proposition? So at least if I don't necessarily agree with the direction, I can understand the underlying rationale and logic for where you're coming from. And then I can critique you in terms that are relevant to you. This bit she said, I really love. She said, so often students describe a project rather than explain a project. Isn't that interesting? Describing maybe what you're looking at rather than what it does, how it works. And Helen's main aim is she wants to be a good juror. She wants to give you good critique. And to do that, she needs a clear explanation. And then after you graduate from uni, it can feel a little bit like this. So, you know, again, you're at the bottom of the ladder, you're in a new environment, you're not quite sure of the rules, but everybody else seems to know. But generally, you're keen to participate. You need to learn how to communicate in the real world in a professional sense. And again, I chatted to a friend who's a principal of a small to medium landscape architecture firm. And he said he wishes that his recent graduates had three qualities, three attributes. One was the confidence to share ideas and contribute ideas in a collaborative way. so confidence. 2 was the ability to listen and take on feedback, just to listen and take on feedback. And 3 was the ability to be flexible with design ideas and not just stick to the first one you have. What I thought was very interesting about that was what he's really looking for in a new employee has more to do with communication than design. Yes, he wants you to be confident. He wants you to have ideas, but it's the way that we share them and the way that we are with each other about our ideas that can really make a difference in the profession. Can give you an advantage. And then, you know, this is a hysterical picture of, you know, stock photo of real world architects in a business meeting. Amazing. We all wear our hard hats inside, I'll have you know. But what I do like about it is that it's actually the case that often in a meeting, you will be with a number of other professionals who've all done different degrees. They all have their own jargon. And your job is to bring an idea to the table and get people on side, see what they think of it, listen to how they bring their technical expertise and their experience, hopefully to make the idea stronger and more robust. So our communication skills are put into practice all the time. And it's our job to make our work clear and interesting. So what's really important actually is the people that end up in our work. So again, this is a picture of Helen Lockhead, who used to be my boss at the Government Architect's Office. And she's presenting to a community group in Broken Hill. I'm sitting there working the slides. It's very old technology. The people in the room are people that live in Broken Hill. They're out on a weeknight. They're listening to some people who've flown in from Sydney, tell them about their town. And Helen is stuck in the corner behind a lectern. She's got a fake plant there. But what I love about it is that you can see her using her hands. She's trying to, above the lectern, she's trying to connect with everybody. She speaks with a lot of passion. Our job can be fairly difficult sometimes to reach people who might be tired, hungry, hostile. What do we do then? How do we make our ideas interesting, relevant? How do we engage people? Some of you might think, well, what's all the big deal about words? So shouldn't our drawings be telling the story? We often forget that we need training to read a plan. We need to be taught how to read a section. Most people don't have that training either. And the other thing is that when people are looking at a drawing, they can all see different things. They don't necessarily see what you see. People interpret visuals differently. So again, adding words to your visuals when you communicate your work can really help people know and be clear about what your message is. You might already be getting an inkling of the challenge. Although this cartoon is about scientists, so it's got all these cards from scientists' families going, well done, doing well at whatever it is you do. We still don't understand your work at all, but we are very proud of you. Congratulations, but please don't try and explain it again. Has anyone tried to explain their project to their family or their friends? Friends not in architecture. It takes a lot of effort. Sometimes you don't even make the effort because you're like, ah, it'd take too long to understand. They won't get it. They don't get it. But my point is that these are actually the moments where we practice communicating our ideas. It's at that level of family, friends, people with English as a second language. The clearer you can make it to people who are very far from your world, from this world of architecture and design, the better skills you develop. It's also easy to overwhelm people with too much information. And in the profession, there's also a bit of a mythology around the architect as a bit of mystery about what we do. And this t-shirt expresses that. It says an architect, someone that solves a problem you didn't know you had in a way that you don't understand. See also wizard, magician. Some people love that. Some architects cultivate that. What do you think? Do you think we should maintain the mystery or break down some of these barriers? I think you know where I stand. I love this website where you press that button down the bottom, excuse the swearing, make bullshit, and a phrase pops up in the box. Okay, inundate post-urban nodes, that sounds pretty intellectual. Sounds really familiar to me. And it generates all of these different phrases each time you click. And I find it just a really great example of jargon. So this is technical terminology that they've just combined in random ways. Actually, this last one, I'm sure I've used in a presentation, engage interstitial solutions. But I'd like us to become aware of the language that we speak and who's in the room when we speak it. Typically, this type of language may be fine in an end of year presentation, but keep it in mind when you're talking to others, when you go out into the profession and there may be a client in the room that hasn't done an architecture degree, what language are you going to use to connect with that client? And then there's masters of communication that we might look to for inspiration, the late, great Steve Jobs. Should we be aiming for this? Should we be aiming for a slick show, something that wows people, a performance of types? I argue that we shouldn't. I don't think that should be our aim. I believe our aim should be to share an idea in a way that people can grab onto, a way that people can see themselves. I want to broaden our reach so that others can help us to champion what we do. Architecture is not particularly well known. It's not particularly well valued even in the society at large. So I think that starts with us and how we talk about our work. This is how I see it. So the design communication cycle, it starts with us, starts with me, the designer. This is Roberto Burley Marx, a fantastic Brazilian landscape architect, covering himself with tropical plants. Each of us are very personal in the way we design. It's a creative, personal process. We bring our experience and our background to it. Everyone's different. Then we put all of that creativity into our work. We live and we breathe it. Then there's the moment where we need to share it with other people. We need them to be part of our project. Then we listen to what they have to say. There's feedback. And then we debrief on that process. We think about how that was, how we presented it, what feedback we got. And then we take that into our next project. So that's the cycle that I see. It needs to kind of start within us, come outside of us, get all this feedback from other people. And in that moment of the presentation that we do, those nerve-wracking reviews that we might do, those big meetings that we prepare for, speeches, we think about that afterwards in a debriefing and we learn from it. We take that information and that knowledge, that experience into our next project. So the key principles of today are distill the message, that's number one. Tell the story is number two. And own the stage is number three. So distill the message is about content, knowing what you want to say, saying it clearly. Tell the story is about structure. Think about who you're talking to, what information do they need, and in what order. And then own the stage is about delivery. It's about confidence and building confidence in your own style of communication. Let's start with distill the message. You generally only have a few minutes to get and hold somebody's attention. They want to know what your idea is and why it should matter to them. If you can get this info across quickly, then you have more time for useful feedback and discussion. This section is going to help you generate content, reflect on your design decisions, and then choose the relevant information to include in your presentation. There's a famous quote by a French mathematician and philosopher called Blaise Pascal, where he says, in a letter to his friend, he says, I apologise for the length of this letter. I lacked the time to make it shorter. And one of the presidents of the United States, the 28th President Woodrow Wilson, not the current, he was asked a question about the time he spent preparing speeches, and he gave a really fascinating answer. He said, it depends on the length of the speech. A 10-minute speech takes me all of 2 weeks to prepare. A half-hour speech takes me a week. But if I can talk for as long as I want, it requires no preparation at all. I'm ready now. So we know from those two things that distilling our message takes time and it takes effort. But I want to make clear that our intention is not to dumb down. You might have heard that phrase, oh, but it's dumbing it down, dumbing down a complex technical idea. That's not the way I see it. I see it as an effort to be clear, to respect others' intelligence. They just don't have the training that I have with my degree, that you have with your degree. It's an effort to convey the guts of the thing, the heart of the matter, clearly. But how to start? First of all, let's generate some content. We've got all of our drawings, we've got all the thoughts in our head. How do we think about it? I like this quote. First step towards clarity is getting everything out and in one place. There's a fantastic video on YouTube. I've got a link in the resources. Kevin Huey and Andrew Maynard of Archie Marathon. I've got a YouTube channel and a website. And they have a fantastic video called The What, Why, How of Architecture, Critical Thinking. A way of thinking about your work and how to communicate it. So the what is, what is it? What have I made? As we go through this, have a think about your project. Hold your project in your mind. What have I made? Think about it objectively. Can you describe the form or the composition, the object or the strategy? Imagine your audience sitting in front of you going, oh, what am I looking at? It's something that you should be able to draw as a diagram or articulate as a sentence. What is it? What have I done?
What have I done?
Number two is, why is it like that? So why does it look like that? Why have I made certain choices? What are the external factors that influence my decisions? Why is my project that shape, that location, that size? Help the audience understand the reasoning behind your project, why it looks like it does, why it is what it is. What are the principles? Why is it like that and not another way? There are many ways to design things. Why is your design like this? And then the third question is, how does it work? So what are the implications and benefits of your project? How do people experience it? How do they move through it? How does the concept respond to the surrounding environment? So help the audience understand how your proposal manifests and what it means for its setting. It's a great way to start, that what plus why plus how. And it's funny that the what and why, if you can articulate what you've done and why it is like it is and articulate that as a sentence, that's it, that's your concept. And then the how is the detail behind it. Here's the benefits, here's what you get by doing it this way. So the first way, the first exercise that I have for you to think about these questions, and again, these are in the worksheets, but I'm just going to run through you how to do it now. Three methods. So you could generate a list, you could make a list, you could map it out if you're more diagrammatic, or you could talk it out if you're a very verbose type of person and you just, you know, have your best thoughts when you're talking. So here's how they work. So make a list. There are three columns. The what, why, how are at the top of each column. When you map it out, we do a mind map. I'll show you in a minute. But you start with your project in the center and you use those questions to generate circles of information on a page. And then talking it out, you pretty much ask yourself those questions. What have I done? Why does it look like it is? How does it work? And you record yourself talking about that. Or you might have a friend interview you asking those questions. And then you'd listen back and write down some of those key phrases. So I've taken a project that I worked on a few years ago, Broken Hill, and this is the type of thing that you generate when you do the list, the what, why, the how. So I just started going, well, what have I made? What is it? It's a strategy for the main street of Broken Hill that uses light and colour to tell the story of the town. Great. Then if I move across to the why column, why? Because light and colour and minerals are defining elements of Broken Hill, and it's important that the design is of its place. And the how is, again, using some of those elements to showcase new technology, to showcase the history in a contemporary way. And again, just don't worry too much about what I've done for my project. I want you to apply these more to your own project. What have I done? Why have I done it? How does it work? And then this map format can just be handy to see something visually. You just take an A3 bit of paper, write your project in the center, and then these bigger circles here are showing you the what. What have I made? What is it? Is it sculptural lighting? Is it streetscape improvements? Something physical and something, but not even physical, it's more solid. What is it? It's a step-by-step plan towards economic revitalization. Great. The smaller circles around those big ones might go into the why. Why is it like that? Why have I done it like that? And then there could be another sphere or another kind of level of things that go into the how. How does it work? What are the benefits? What are the implications? So a map can be really useful. A list can be really useful. And then just talking about it can also be super useful. You know, I walk around the garden with my phone talking, you know, looking like a mad woman, talking about my project. And you can get some really good phrases and information out of your head and recorded, and then you just write them down. So think about how you like to think. You could give each of these a try if you like. I find that you generate a different perspective on your project just by doing each of those three things, more word-based. You might see physical relationships in the map-based. And then you might just come out with some great phrases when you talk it out. After you've done each of those things, you might look over, take a few minutes to look over what you've produced and see if there's a clear message coming out of it. Maybe out of the what answers to the what questions, you'll identify, well, that's the key thing. That's the main why. And you might also have generated enough content to realize, well, that bit of info is going to support that key message. So you collate and you curate just the bits of information. Once you've identified that key message, just the bits of information that support it. That's really important for when you're doing a short speech. You just want to make sure that it has a single key message. We'll talk about that in structure in just a second. But the process of doing these things, generating content, getting stuff out on a page, and then taking a few minutes to reflect and look over them can be a really great way to start to prepare for a presentation rather than panicking and freaking out about how it's all going to go together. I do that a lot myself, and you can probably just see on my wall here, I've got mind maps for everything and lists for everything, different projects I've got coming up. I find it really useful. So to recap, that's the end of the first section on distill the message. What we want to do is just make a bit of time to think before our presentation happens. Think about what we want to communicate, the what, why, how of our work. Get your thoughts down, write it down, draw it out, talk it out, you know, all in one place. Think about what you've produced and then try and articulate what's the central idea. Try and do it in a sentence. It's well worth your time. Do we have any questions on that first section that you can see, Emma?
No, there's nothing in the chat, but... Does anyone have any questions?
No worries. If you think about anything, If you think about anything, then pop it in there and we can answer it later. So section one, distill the message, arguably the most important thing, know what you want to say. Step two is tell the story. And by this, I don't necessarily mean tell a bedtime story, tell a childish story, tell a narrative. It doesn't have to be flowery or, I'm trying to think of the word. It doesn't actually have to be a narrative. I'm talking about structure. That's one of the most important aspects of a presentation. It's your chance to curate the order, the focus, and the quantity of information that you share with your audience. And you need to keep in mind what your key message is, keep in mind the situation you're presenting in, and your audience. Who's there? Who's in the room? So it's a little bit like, this is a Disney kind of storyboard here, but it's a little bit like what a filmmaker does, what an animator does, what a journalist does, where when they have a key message, they make sure that it is presented to you in a way that you do not miss it. It's impossible to miss. Journalists have their lead of their story. They have it up front. Filmmakers would maybe build to a climax and have that message in a way that you really remember. So I'm trying to encourage us to think about, what's the best way to structure my information? There's also evidence that audiences can only hold a limited amount of information in their head at one time. So there's an impetus for us to group our information under a few points. You know, they say, you know, 5 is ideal, plus or minus 2. So 3 points is great. 7 points is maybe a little bit too much. 5 is fine. But try and group your information under a few headings or a few kind of key points, because that will make it heaps easier for your audience to remember. And it's our job to make their role to understand our work. It's our job to make it easy for them. And they're more likely to remember it afterwards. So it doesn't actually particularly matter what type of structure you choose, as long as it has a clear beginning, middle, and end, a bit of a logical flow to it, and a single key message. So the worksheet 2 that I've given you gives you some options for how to structure your work. And once you've organized it in a simple way like this, say high level, you can always include supporting information. You can expand or contract that supporting information to suit the length of time that you have. If you've got a 5-minute slot, then you keep it high level. You say the key points, you really distill what those key points are. If you've got 20 minutes or half an hour, you put in more supporting information underneath your key points. You elaborate, you put in detail, you put in more examples. You could stretch that to an hour if you need to. But the structure remains the same. I'm just going to go through 3 types really quickly, 3 types of structure. One's a well-known, tried and true academic structure. One is a sequential structure. And one is a more story-based structure. So an academic structure, it has an introduction, a body, and a conclusion. In the body, you might have 3 to 5 key points. It's really well known. It's fairly straightforward. I would say if you're, you know, feeling a bit overwhelmed with all of the information you have at the moment, just stick to an academic structure for your presentation. In the intro, you'd state your topic and area of focus, your research question, any limitations. You'd outline your main points. In the body, you'd elaborate on your main points in order. And then in your conclusion, you'd summarize the findings of those main points. Fairly simple. I'm going to show you a quick example for my Broken Hill project in an academic structure. So this is just me presenting to you. Good morning, everybody. Today I'm going to talk to you about Broken Hill, a remote desert town seeking to transition from its economy from mining to tourism. I want to share my proposal to bring life back into the city centre. specifically how to increase tourism and improve safety in the historic Main Street through two ways, streetscape improvements and lighting. I also study traffic, vegetation and drainage, but I won't be covering those aspects in this presentation. Feel free to ask me questions later. My first point, streetscape improvements. Each street in Broken Hill is named after the minerals mined there. Chloride, oxide, sulfide street, iodide street. My proposal uses those minerals as inspiration for paving, planting, furniture and public art, partly as a wayfinding device and partly to encourage people to walk the full length of the street. And my second point, lighting. I did a study that showed how the perfect light in Broken Hill attracts artists, photographers and filmmakers, leading to a thriving art scene that brings the town to life at night. And then when you take that into an urban situation, there's a way to light the main street in a subtle way that doesn't interrupt the open, expansive quality of the urban form. And that line of light down the main street could lead you to an incredible destination artwork on the route, which links to a huge pile of mining waste on the edge of town. And then to conclude, you can see that by showcasing the minerals and the incredible light of this desert town, these things combined could address tourism and safety at the same time. Then you'd say, thank you, that concludes my presentation. I'll open to the floor now for some questions. Just something as basic as that. It's very simple and straightforward. This is the second type of structure you could use, which is sequential. This is quite common in an architectural or design presentation. It's a logical, easy to follow structure. You lead your audience step by step through the project. Your sequence can be ordered by a number of things. It could be time, past, present, future. It could be scale, macro to micro, strategic to detailed. It could be process, started with research, went through an ideation process, ended up in a final concept. It could even be spatial. What's the spatial sequence of things? How do components and things relate to each other? So sequential can be also a very clear structure for a presentation. And if we did Broken Hill sequentially, we would say something about flying in for the first time, looking at this isolated city in the middle of the desert. Its inhabitants are tough and resilient. We analyze the main street. There's great things about it, historic buildings, it's wide and uncluttered, but it needed to be safer and more inviting. Our concept used lighting and colour as Broken Hill as a guiding principle for our plan. And the mineral names of the streets, the main street is Argent Street, which is Latin for silver, helped us draw on links and views to the surrounding streets to knit the main street in with the rest of the urban fabric. Lighting was also a key driver, our line of light forming a high-tech lighting system that linked the town to the line of load, the mining waste, where a community-led artwork forms a backdrop for destinations by day and night. So again, a sequential thing of just leading you through the process of what we did on that project from huge scale, from that, you know, whole of desert scale to the final concept of the thing we produced. So that's two ways, academic, sequential, and then here's a story structure, which is interesting, which is, it's all about contrast. So you start off with a description of what's the existing situation. You describe that in broad strokes. And then you contrast that with your vision, what could be. You use the central part of the structure to highlight different contrasts. You know, flip back and forth between what is and what my vision is. What is, and then the final way you end that story is, you know, with a great vision of how it could be transformed, or the strongest part of the vision. What could the new reality be? So this structure is engaging. It's quite easy for people to remember. Let's try Broken Hill like that. So we'd say something like, What's the existing situation? Broken hills built on mining, silver, lead and zinc. It's in the middle of the desert. It's isolated. Its people are resilient and tough. Unlike many regional centres, big box shopping centres are drawing the life out of the main street. And with less people around, shops are closing down and crime is on the rise. Contrast it with the vision. What if the main street could be a focal point with lots of things to do for locals and visitors and become once again a thriving strip that draws people out of their cars and encourages public life? Is there a way to celebrate what makes Broken Hill special without alienating the locals and gentrifying it into something unrecognisable? Back to existing. This is the main street today. It's open, it's wide, there's a pub at one end and a train station at the other, with not much in between. Imagine if each intersection had its own character. So as you worked your way up the main street, at each corner there was somewhere to sit, somewhere to learn about local native plants and local art, chances to engage with local businesses, all inspired by the name of the street that you're on. Back to existing. The clear desert light makes Broken Hill a magnet for photographers and artists. Why not make light the language of Broken Hill, starting with a high-tech form of street lighting that's not seen anywhere else? You could contrast the old with the new and demonstrate that Broken Hill, while historic, isn't stuck in time. It's utilising technology and art to create a tourist destination as well as local business opportunities. And rather than mining relics stuck in a dusty museum, you could bring these stories into the centre of town physically, culminating in an artwork that draws visitors to see how Broken Hill's looking to the future for reinvention. So what I've just shown you is three ways to present a project. Same project, same drawings. So it's up to you to think about what type of structure is going to make sense for my project. And as I said, it doesn't particularly matter which one you choose, as long as you have one. So your presentation has to have a structure. It's just going to make it heaps easier for people to understand and recall. And you want them to remember it because you want them to give you really useful feedback. So to recap, I want you to choose a structure, plan how you're going to start, know what your key message is and communicate that, have 3 to 5 key points. You can prepare supporting information for each point, but know that you might not get to all of that. So practice so that you fit within your time, the time you have available, and have that supporting information up your sleeve. And then make sure you plan an ending, which can just be a very simple thank you, that concludes. We'll now move into discussion. Or you might end on a really strong vision and just say thank you. Do we have any thoughts on structure or any questions on structure at this point? We've now talked about distill the message. We've talked about structuring information.
I'm curious, with the academic format, you're saying that that's kind of tried and tested, but you know, when you see students presenting in that type of mode versus the others, like, what is the standout difference? Like, what is the value of putting the time into the sequential or the story-based versus the academic?
I think that the second types of presentations, the sequential and the story, have potential to be more evocative. So, and again, it's quite a personal thing. So evocative for me. So the types of presentations that I respond to are ones where my imagination is engaged, or I'm taken on a bit of a journey. I quite enjoy a narrative. Not everybody is like that. Some people are much more logical. Some people actually don't like narratives. Some people much prefer to just be told in sequence what you did, what are the key points, what do I need to think about it? Okay, got it. So yeah, I think I think that the key thing to do is choose the structure that suits you and your work, and realize that, we'll talk about this in the next section, but I don't think there's any one right way to do it. I think it's much more important to do something that you are comfortable with and that suits your nature and your work. Because as long as you make it clear, then that's all that matters. Not every presentation has to be the same way. I think it's good to have some variety even.
And even thinking about your audience, like your design presentation to your crits, might be academics or creative professionals, might be different to a potential client and pitching for work or something. Yeah.
Yes, that's a really good point.
We've got a question from Amber. Go for it, Amber.
Hi. Yeah, that's a really good way of breaking it down. I think I've been struggling with that and sort of did what you tried to do, that sort of thing. But I think I've come up with, for my personal project, sequential. And I was wondering your thoughts on, obviously we're presenting to architecture, an architecture panel. Would you say to start with, this is the architectural outcome, then here's how I got to it, and then come back to the outcome? Like, should you touch on the, basically what they want to know, the project first, to engage them, I guess?
I think that can be, that's a great question, Amber. I think that's can be a really engaging way to do a presentation, yes. Often your audience will want to know what your outcome is. They'll want to know what the proposal is as soon as possible.
Mm.
So, yes, that can be really effective. Sometimes it takes a bit of practice to be able to structure a presentation like that. It's easier to just go from beginning to end and end with the final.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking initially, but then I thought in terms of presenting to people that have been listening to people all day, that they might not get engaged.
Yeah, I think that's spot on. And it sounds like you've already done a bit of thinking about it, so I think you're probably in a good position to try and work out a strong start that might include that outcome, might include the
and you touched
the final proposal.
You also touched before on written words versus imagery. Yeah. And I think another question I had was in terms of like the narrative and the process of how I got to things, a lot of it is a written component. So, yeah, I guess a bit of advice on how you pair visuals with something that might not have been visual when you, found it out, I guess.
Yeah, the balance of visual and verbal. Again, that's great. I tend to think that, again, each individual is different. And if words have been a big part of your process and investigation and design work, then yeah, put as much time into crafting the words as you have into your visuals. Yeah, I mean, I'd love to hear what your tutors would think of that too, Emma and Irina.
I've just got a little question. Do you think that you can go too far with the kind of, I'm thinking of politicians putting off people by being too watertight with the way they communicate.
Yes.
Do you choosing how you present to different kind of groups so that you're actually kind of, you're better received by them. Do you think, so how would you kind of negotiate that?
Yeah, I love that question. So as I was saying before, where I was showing the picture of Steve Jobs, and you might kind of say, that's a type of politics in itself. I think our main aim should be to have a clear point of view, to have a great idea, to put the work into that idea. And then when we express it to people, to be as human as possible and to be as, I use the word authentic sometimes, but it just means be like yourself when you communicate it. And the way I kind of measure that is if I'm giving a talk or something like that, if I imagine my best friends or my family or my mum even in the audience, would she think I looked like me? Would she think I sounded like me? People that know me, that's my measure of authenticity. So you don't ever want to feel like you are weaving a kind of talking the talk with nothing behind it. I think that's the main thing. The stuff or the work that we do needs to have substance, needs to be important, needs to be meaningful to us. And that's actually what we're excited about sharing. But I think that tailoring a message to an audience is actually really critical. I don't think the message actually changes. I just think the way that it is presented changes to suit your audience and make sure that they can grab onto it.
I also think it's important to don't be afraid to admit that there are things that you're unsure of. Even when we're doing a presentation to local council or state government, we're quite happy to say, we really want to talk about this bit because we haven't resolved it, or we'd like your thoughts on this. I think there's always, particularly in a review situation, you need to have these invitations for people to step in and take part in the conversation, rather than if something is watertight, the only feedback you will get is criticism, looking for a way in. But if you immediately open the door and say, haven't worked this out yet, we'd really like your thoughts on it, it's a really nice invitation, I think, for a positive discussion about the work rather than a critique of it.
Great point. Okay, any more questions on this section, or shall we move on to section 3?
Shall we move on? Okay. Nothing's popped up in the chat, so.
Okay, great discussion, thank you. So the final step is own the stage. And even though we're not really on stages that much at the moment, we're all on screens, this is about finding your own confidence and your own way of talking, of speaking, and of sharing information. So one of the things, I've watched many, many hours of presentations, and I believe now there's many ways that you can be a compelling presenter and a compelling public speaker. I've seen people read scripts, beautiful scripts, with barely looking up, but the way they've crafted their speech is so moving that I've been in tears. Doesn't matter that they've read it. I've seen people construct amazing arguments just off the top of their head. Amazing. I've been convinced by that. I've seen people that are super, super casual and they'll just be like talking really relaxedly and they might be just draped over the lectern. Well, I've also seen people who are very stiff, very solemn, very focused, very straight down the line. People that are really loud and enthusiastic and excited, and people that are calm, considered, and well-reasoned. So the key thing to explore is, what is your style? How much preparation do you need to feel ready? You don't have to be super slick or polished. That's not the aim. You don't have to be like anybody else, even though we often admire particular speakers. It might be the director of a firm, or it might be a TED talk, or it might be any famous architect that you can think of. You don't have to present like them. Much more important to connect with your audience, make it easy for them to remember your message, and build on your natural strengths. So your natural strengths are the way that you naturally communicate when you're passionate about a topic. It's a way that your friends and family would recognize, there goes Saneia again. She's off on her topic. She loves it. It's how people who know you see you. And it's also about being aware of your habits. And habits is a really interesting one. What do you do instinctively without thinking? Some of these habits could work in your favor and form actually part of your style. Some may end up being a bit distracting and to others, to your audience, and you might need to just have a think about some of them, be aware of them as a starting point. So these exercises and in the worksheets, I offer some tips to help you build confidence and build on your actual natural style. So part of it's body language. Amazing picture of Jerry Seinfeld, and stand-up comics are incredible at using their whole bodies to deliver a punchline. Bodies, face, timing, it's amazing. But body language is very telling. Just in the first few seconds of seeing you, your audience makes judgments about how confident you are, whether you're hesitant, what type of energy you're bringing, whether you need to be heard or ignored, whether you're in charge or subordinate. It's fascinating. What we're trying to do is to make our nonverbal communication, our body language and face, our voice, support our verbal, so support our message and what we're saying. If you're talking about an exciting idea, you want to sound a bit excited, for example. So the first aspect is vocal. And again, with our online communication lately, vocal has become even more important. You'll know just by listening to various presentations that you have, you'll know the things, like the things you should do. You'll know the different things, like whether a voice sounds flat or whether a tone sounds really monotone or boring. Whether someone's talking too loud or too soft is really easy to pick. Too fast or too slow. Inflection is a really interesting vocal one, where you might raise at the end of each sentence. Hi, my name's Saneia and this is my project. I'm here to talk to you about my design. Can you hear at the end of each word I'm going up and it sounds like I'm asking a question? Whereas if you become aware of that and you can go, hi, my name's Saneia, I'm here today to talk to you about my design, and you sound already more confident. So vocal is really interesting. There's also things like pitch, rhythm, repetition, emphasis, clarity. See how I enunciated there? Vocal is really interesting. Actors do a whole lot of tongue twisters and face relaxing exercises to make sure they communicate vocally really clearly. But the key thing to think about is, what are your vocal habits? What are my vocal habits? And maybe you would focus just on, say, tone, volume, and speed as a first instance. They're the most important things. I also want to make the point that breathing really ties into all vocal aspects of communicating. You need to leave yourself enough room to take a deep breath, to be able to project, for one, and to be able to get to the ends of your sentences without getting short of breath. So to support your voice. So opera singers, really experienced public speakers, they know all about this. So vocal has many aspects to it. And the key thing for you to ask yourself is, what are my natural habits? Have a think about that. The next aspect is physical. So I'm talking body language, I'm talking facial expression. We can talk about things when we speak like alignment, posture, stance. Even when you're sitting in a chair, in an office chair, how upright is your spine? Are your feet flat on the floor? Are your shoulders relaxed? We could talk about gestures for physical, eye contact. You might also think about appearance, wear your favorite shirt like I do, props, you know, do you have your drawings handy that you need to gesture to, your slides? How fast should you be moving? What position are you in the frame or on the stage? Are you tense? Are you rocking or swaying? Is your head tilting? So all of these things send a different message. They're all such tiny adjustments. And the first step is to just become aware about, what's my natural habit? And if it is to stand on an angle, or if it is to look everywhere but at the people you're speaking to, become aware of it. See what you might need to change, or alternately build on. And it's also interesting how breathing forms part of this physical aspect as well. So breathing really helps you to relax any of those tensions. And you need to be able to sit or stand up fairly straight to take a good deep breath. And the third aspect is mental. So this is a really interesting one. What's going on in my mind as I'm presenting, as I'm communicating? It's about being prepared for things that you might not have expected to happen, to be able to be in the present. You know, for example, you might have a question from left field, you might have a heckler in the audience, there might be a tech malfunction that you need to deal with. And again, it's just about being prepared and being able to go with the flow when something different happens to what you expect. It's also a bit about self-talk. It's a bit about how you you know, when you're in the middle of a presentation, are you thinking, oh, you're just like, this is terrible. What are you doing? Need to get off the stage, just get this over with. Or are you positive and a bit like a coach? Are you going, come on, you can do this. You're doing great. It's going to be awesome. You're nearly there. Again, being aware of what voices do you have and how do they affect you? Some ways to prepare and to think about these things. One is to practice in front of someone. So once you've got your, distill your message and you've got your structure, got your story ready, to be able to practice aloud in front of somebody is incredible because it just gives you an awareness and gives you some knowledge of what you're doing that you might not have had any awareness of. So practice aloud in front of someone you trust, a colleague, family member, friend. Ask them for specific feedback. You can ask them, how was the content? How was the structure? How was my delivery? And then ideally leave yourself enough time to incorporate their recommendations and have another practice before the final one. Another thing that I do is I record myself. When I've got a big speech coming up, I'll often write out a whole script, record myself reading it, just, you know, headphones onto my audio app. And then I will listen to myself a number of times, maybe even 20 times if it's probably not 20, but maybe something like 10 times, going for a walk around the streets, doing the dishes at home. I'll listen to myself reading my speech. And what that does is it gets me really familiar with the material. It kind of sinks into my subconscious and it allows me eventually to let go of that script. I would still have dot points. I would still have something as a reference just in case, but it really helps me become familiar with my material. So recording yourself can be great when you're preparing for a speech. And then finally, video yourself. We're all fairly familiar with videoing ourselves these days, but a lot of people still really hate it. They hate watching themselves back. And so it can be challenging, but it's the quickest way to get a picture of your physical habits. Like I was saying before, does my head tilt? Do I stand in a different way? You might be like me and just genetically, you know, your mouth turns down at the corners. So people often think you're sadder or angrier than you actually are. It's those things that you become aware of when you see yourself on video, and rather than fall in a heap and cry, you think about, well, is that something that I can work on? Do I need to? Or is that just part of me? First step is to just be aware. What do I do physically? What are my habits? But the key thing there is not to be too critical of yourself. So a quick reminder about presenting. I love this picture of this architect. She's presenting at a conference. You can see she's got her note cards there. She's got her lucky red shoes on. She's standing upright and she's looking out at the audience. She's making hand gestures and eye contact. All the things. And if I were to give you 5 tips on what to do to prepare for a presentation physically, number 1 would be check your tech. And that just means have a practice on the actual computer, on the actual microphone before you give your big presentation. The more important the presentation is, the more important it is to practice. Number 2 is speak to be heard. That just means when you're in a room with people, you check that your voice is carrying to the person who is furthest away from you in the room. Speak to be heard. People need to hear you. It's a basic thing. Look at the audience. So even if you're reading your speech, if you look up from time to time, if you're at home like I am, look into the camera. It's that moment where you connect with your audience. And you can also build in pauses in your speech that make it easier for your audience to remember and recall things. So even after you've made a key point, when you're making a key point, look at the audience. Breathe, again, back to the breathing. So the breathing, again, helps your voice, helps the blood get to your extremities and your brain, helps you think more clearly. and face the audience. So this is more one when you're in person, and many presentations that I've seen, the presenter will be standing and pointing to their slides, sometimes even back to the audience, with their back to the audience. So always stay facing front as much as you can. And as Tom was saying before, so a presentation, even if it looks as formal as that behind a lectern, not a whole lot of chance for questions, it would seem, you can build them into your presentation. You can still ask the audience questions. Treat it more as a conversation. And as we know, one of the most challenging aspects of our work is that after the presentation, it's not over. We remain up in front of everybody and we listen to some feedback. We listen to what people think. When it's positive feedback, when it's complimentary, that feels great. It's really nice to have everybody hearing that. When it's, you might say, constructive criticism, when it's negative, when it's not easy to hear, then that can be really, really difficult. So our defense mechanisms can kick in. We might become argumentative, we might feel upset. I've certainly had my share of juries in university where I was close to tears. And that can be sometimes just because we're so close to the work, we're feeling particularly sensitive or vulnerable, maybe not had enough sleep, all of those things. And your perspective can just be a bit off. Your perspective can be, you're just so close to it. So hearing any feedback that feels critical, feels unjustified, can be hard to handle. But again, the more we think of it like a conversation, here I am today sharing some work with you. I'm keen to know what you think. And your reviewers typically have really good intentions. They want to help. They want to help you grow as a designer. They want to make your work better. So what can we do? First thing we need to do is to listen. So make sure you understand what they're saying to you. If you're getting some critique, listen to them. Let the person critiquing you finish. Don't interrupt them. Clarify. If I understand you rightly, you're commenting on this aspect of my proposal. Is that right? And then you respond. So rather than just immediately responding, oh, but that's not what I thought at all. That's not what I intended. Take the moment to do the first two steps, listen and clarify before responding. And then when you do respond, keep it professional. So you can direct your answer to the entire audience. Even when you feel a bit hard done by, you could just put it down to a bad day on the reviewer's part potentially. And it really serves you well if you're able to remain calm. Again, try that breathing. And avoid the temptation to answer defensively or sarcastically. I know that's really challenging, but it's something, again, that will hold you in good stead in the profession. Really super important step, debriefing. After the presentation, grab a friend who was there and process. Process how you felt, what you heard, what worked and what didn't. And take that really valuable information into your next project. Because each time you do give a presentation, you learn so much, you benefit. And all of that experience is building you into a strong designer. So nerves are so, so common. You know, how often do you just want to be like this dog and not actually do your presentation at all? Like, can I just stay here? But they're so common. People experience them really personally and differently. So say there's a spectrum from just a little, you know, butterflies in the stomach on one end and then just full-blown terrifying panic attack on the other. So anywhere in the middle. It's a fight or flight response. You feel like you're in danger. Your adrenaline's up, your heart's racing, you're breathing shallowly. You might have a tight jaw, a wobbly voice, hands shaking, legs shaking, dry mouth, sweating. It's primal. It's full on. So the best thing I can offer here, because I don't feel like nerves ever go away completely, and even really confident people who I've interviewed still admit to feeling nervous, even though you can't tell. My tip here is to become aware of how nerves affect you and put strategies in place that deal with them. And so by doing that, the key thing you have to do is actually keep putting yourself in situations where you learn and grow from nerves. Keep saying yes to presentations. But here are some strategies. Before we get to strategies, this is one of the worksheets. So something you can do, this whole part of becoming aware of your thoughts, your nerves when you present, and then reflect on what worked well and what you do differently next time. I've included a worksheet that helps you guide you through that process. So you can use it a number of times, note down what types of nerves you felt, what types of thoughts you had, get to know it. And then also on the sheet, just pick out one or two things you did well and one or two things you'd do differently. That's all you need to do. The key thing is practice. And feedback here. So feedback is when you would give somebody else an evaluation on their speech, not necessarily a design review. Again, you'll see these clearly in the worksheets that you have, but I've outlined three columns here where you might comment on the content, structure, and delivery of someone else's speech. And there's tips also for being constructive when you give that feedback. Note something they did well, one or two things they did well, one aspect that could be improved, and one thing they could do differently. And also reflect on how different they are to you to get a better picture of your own style. Okay, so back to nerves. So stage fright, practice and preparation, mindset, encouragement and reward, power poses. There's a number of things you can do. So this practice and preparation one, it's about having a ritual. It's about knowing how you prepare yourself for a speech. What do you need? How much time? What type of notes? Do you need a diagram instead? How many times do you need to practice? It's getting to know what's right for you. Sorry. And then mindset is, it's really interesting, this one. I find that when I'm preparing for a talk and people are asking me, oh, you're nervous about your big talk coming up. Oh, wow, you must be nervous. Big talk. And I reply to them, actually, no, I'm just excited. I'm super pumped for this. I can't wait. I kind of lie. And in that way, framing my own nerves as excitement helps me. It helps me go, yeah, no, I can do this. It just frames something negative in a positive way, rather than going, yeah, I'm really nervous, and then thinking about that and then getting even more nervous. So mindset can be a good thing too. Encouragement and reward, that is really simple. It's just after I do this hard thing, this talk, this presentation, I'm going to do this great thing that I love doing, whatever that is, buy something online, hang out with some friends, eat something amazing, just plan a treat for yourself because it's not easy. And then power poses. This is just a fun thing, which it has some research behind it that's been a bit controversial. There's a link to a TED talk in the resources sheet. But the theory is that if you take a pose like this, like a Wonder Woman pose that's upright, your shoulders are back and down, your hands might be on your hips and your legs planted, chin up, you're opening yourself up and you're making yourself as big as possible. And what that does a number of things. It increases hormones that make you feel more powerful and decreases stress hormones. And the other thing that it does, it just lets you breathe. It opens up your body so that you can take a good, clear breath. But it also can make you feel a bit like a superhero. This is another power pose as well, with your arms up in the air like a V, like Usain Bolt here. And again, the theory is that you do this somewhere private before your speech. You might do it in the toilet or in the hotel room or wherever you are, in the room next to wherever you're giving your speech. You can do it at home now. Hold that pose for a minute or two, take deep breaths, and just feel how it shifts nerves in your body. Give it a try. So to recap, so to own the stage, to get more confident and to build confidence in your own style of presenting, it's about finding your own preparation ritual, checking your tech, speaking to be heard, looking at your audience. welcoming feedback, listen, clarify, then respond, and debrief afterwards. What thing, what are you going to do differently next time? Any questions there on owning the stage?
Hi.
Hi.
Just had a question about like nonverbal cues that you talked about before.
Yeah.
I heard like the majority of our communication is mostly nonverbal. So like body language and tone, and only about like less than 10% is about what's said, like the content.
Yes.
I wanted to know what your thoughts on that were.
Yes, I've thought about this a fair bit. Thank you for bringing that up. My thoughts on that are that the message is critical. So even though it's the thing that is least absorbed, it's the thing that has the least likelihood of being absorbed, people are going to be absorbing and making meaning from your body, from your face, from the tone of your voice, more than actually what you say. I think for our work, the message and the idea that we're communicating is absolutely critical. So it doesn't mean that it doesn't matter what you say. It really, really matters. The way I kind of see it is just that we're funny individuals. Humans are just funny. We become distracted and we think about lots of things. We take in information on heaps and heaps of levels. And the more I think about it, the more I realize there's a really good argument for distilling your message. So again, you know that your audience is going to be distracted by all of these other things. So it's well worth your while to streamline your nonverbal, streamline your body language, your face, your voice, to all support that message, to give it a better chance of being remembered, heard and remembered. So I think it all ties in. It all comes back to those three things, but that's why I put distill the message as number one. Make sure, and I actually spend more time on distill the message and tell the story, because I believe that's actually the critical thing for us. As architects and as designers, we're ideas people, we're making things, creating things. That's what we really need to share.
Great, thanks.
Hi, Saneia.
Hi.
I think that there is always that sense of nerves, and the fact that it's okay to have nerves is, it's human. But for these students, especially in a Zoom environment where all of a sudden everyone's watching, but they may not have the screens on, so you don't know who you're speaking to. Like it can make you feel even more nervous in presenting. What are maybe some tips about presenting on Zoom with some of these points that you've given?
Yeah, great. Voice is hugely important. So voice, you need to sound excited, or not necessarily excited. Your voice needs to have energy. And that's something that can be hard to kind of whip up when you're just yourself at home. So it's, again, finding some of those kind of tricks to do. And something I do, you might notice I'm actually standing at the moment. I've got a stand-up desk and my computer's up. I found I needed that to be standing, to have energy, to talk to you today and sound interested and excited in what I'm saying, which I am. So that's one thing, vocal energy. Another thing is getting used to looking into the camera. Because one of the things I do is I imagine, a bit like an actor, I guess, looking into the camera. I imagine that I'm looking at somebody, even that a friend of mine is at the other end of that camera. So it's just talking to the camera as if you would a person. What else? I think it's, again, check your tech becomes even more important as well, and do a practice. I've got some lighting set up in here that's a little bit more flattering than my normal office lights. Can be just things like that too. Everyone's looking great, by the way. But it's one of those things where you can have a little bit more focus on things that are in camera. I know some people like to curate their backgrounds. I haven't done mine today. So if you've got, you know, messy things up on the wall and my husband's Lego collection at the back. So it's up to you, I think. There's a number of things you can do, but I would promote voice and lighting and speed. So make sure you don't go too fast. It's really easy to lose connection with how your audience is keeping up with you. So again, working in some breaths, some pauses into your vocal presentation.
Excellent. I would also add that every Zoom session that you have with your studio is kind of an opportunity to practice, so that when you get to the final, it's not all of a sudden you changing positions or changing the environment.
Yes.
But you've become comfortable with it. So for those who might sort of sit and, you know, have two screens and be looking out there all the time, you know, start practicing now in those smaller groups when you're having a one-to-one with your tutor. And I often also turn off the screen so I don't see everyone. I don't feel daunted by who's in the room. I just keep very focused, you know, just to reduce the potential that you suddenly become overwhelmed midway through your presentation.
Yeah. Yes.
So learning those little tips as well, how to adjust your environment is handy. But I think, you know, I would love it. I love everyone to go away after this and actually, yeah, really practice and get familiar with their habits and nerves. And, you know, I know that there was a comment in the chat just saying that even when you do prepare and you're still so nervous and your heart's racing, like,
yes,
how do I get over that?
Oh, I like that question. Yeah. I think I've kind of got good news and bad news about that question, because I don't feel that nerves ever really go away. And the bugger about nerves is that it's not a nice feeling to have. It can be quite unpleasant. But the way I look at them now, it's not with the aim of presenting without nerves. It's accepting that if I care about this presentation, I want to do a good job and I've prepared for it, it's important to me, I know I'm going to feel nervous. And so it's about having those strategies to help, knowing what I'm going to do when I have my dry mouth, I'm going to have a glass of water handy. Knowing what I'm going to do if my leg starts shaking, I'm just going to go, hello, shaky leg, I expected you. Things like that. And then having those rewards to do afterwards. So I think it's accepting that nerves are a part of life when you are challenging yourself and you're growing. And as I said, even the most expert presenters, confident seeming presenters, just about all feel nerves when they're in that same situation. I think it's part of being human. So it's just about mitigating the really extreme feelings of nerves, doing whatever you need to do to handle that. Try and become a bit more comfortable. Practice.
And know that your audience aren't there to attack you.
No.
And I think that was a great point about inviting conversation. If you set up that space as a sharing, like you feel more comfortable. It's not about them against me. I think that also helps nerves.
Then yeah. I think because this workshop is not only about your final presentation, it is about what are you going to do in the near future when you are practicing your own practice, working for a big practice, and eventually you are going to be in front of the regional government, the council, who knows. A very angry community just because there are many troubles in the community and so on. So I think something that really helped when presenting is realizing, or even presenting your final PhD, is realizing that you are the person who has been putting more care and love in this project, if it's the case, but it's going to be the case because I know all our students and it's going to be the case. And I think feeling proud of that and be aware of that and just being relaxed in the sense that, as Saneia has been saying, not being kind of responding and being open to conversation and kind of sharing with the other and open to listen to the other and those kind of things and being yourself and being authentic. So you went through such an amount of very important things that are going to really help you to yeah, kind of. So in the end, we are going to be in the final presentation, a bunch of people you already know and one guest you don't know. And this is going to be easy, but the future is going to be challenging. So what I would say is feel proud of yourself and your work, and that will help you to be more confident, even if you get nervous, because it's going to happen. But
yeah, that's great.
Can I just ask one more question? Just about, and you kind of alluded to how you do this before, but about trying to get one of, you know, a presentation where you aren't looking at your palm cards or your text, and yet you don't lose kind of like particular phrases. You know, I'm thinking of like two different presentations I've done where I've fully written it out and I've read it kind of verbatim. And it was like, you know, I feel like I gained points for being, you know, accurate and precise, but then probably lost some of the attention of the people in the audience. And you see people give these presentations where they are like so crisp and, but like also really engaging. So yeah, just how, like how people do this. You said before you listen to yourself and times, but if there are any other tips to kind of work that out.
Yeah, I think that's for me, like exactly like you said, that's the ultimate aim, where I'm still, because I love words, where I still keep some of the phrasing that I've worked really hard on, and I make those points exactly like I wanted them to make, but I'm not reading. And I think that just comes with practice. If you have that aim to be that type of presenter where, you know, you maybe want to move away from a script, but you want to keep some key phrases, I think it's a combination of just practice and trial and error. So the way I've done it is started off with a full-on script, wrote it word for word, slaved over it, quite enjoyed doing it. Some of my early presentations and lectures, I would read that script word for word. As I've become more comfortable with speaking, you know, I tried that recording thing, I'd listen to it, and then I'd work from dot points. Sometimes I would have a sheet that just had my slides on and a couple of scribbled notes. So you go from kind of script to dot points to, I don't know, to potentially being able to speak for short periods of time without any notes and make some great points. But I find that regardless, I still need something. If I know I've got key points to make and I'm quite a prepared type of person, so I like to have a backup, I will still have my notes, I will still have dot points, I'll still have something with me. So for me, that takes away the fear that what if my mind goes blank? I've still got that there.
Do you think it's partly the act of writing the notes that gets it into your mind?
Yes, it can be.
Yeah.
Yes.
Can I offer up as well, Callum? I think there's an opportunity to give yourself clues within your presentation, whether it's a series of boards that you're presenting live or whether it's a PowerPoint or a slideshow, embed within it clues for yourself, whether it's keywords, whether it's phrases, whether it's a graphic image that then triggers you. It's the classic kind of memory theater thing. Yeah. And if you write your script and you say, this word activation is going to remind me to talk about the activation of my project, something you have in your head as a statement. When you see that word, it's not a distraction from your presentation. It belongs there. You might do it graphically. You know, it's. I always write a script because I think your point about writing it down is important because you need to have those phrases in your head. But I never use it because I've embedded every single presentation I do with the visual clues that I need to remind me to say everything. So you've got a presentation and there is a density of information there. Make sure you're using some of that information to talk to yourself.
Nice, thank you. Thanks, Saneia.
Yeah, sure, thank you.
Saneia, how about personal question. I'm terrible. Oh. Personal related to presentation. I'm terrible looking the audience. I cannot, and I don't just to get very nervous. Well, let's see the future, but probably the manner in which I really show that I'm nervous is because I'm not able to look into the faces. And this is something I cannot change, even if I have been trying, because it's something I know is not. And it was good that you remind us that this is a manner of not really connecting with the other. So do you have any tip?
Yes, thank you for sharing that. One of the things that really helps me is to, you start by just looking up once or twice, right? So you might have your speech or whatever it is, or your presentation. And what you try and do is find the person, there's generally one at least, that is looking back at you and smiling. So there's often, there's a theory about this, it's called the charismatic listener. There's often someone in your audience that is going, good point, they're not necessarily saying it, but they might be looking at you, nodding and smiling as they listen. And that person gives you confidence and strength. So you start by looking at that person. And then next time you look up, you might just experiment with looking a little bit at somebody else, maybe come back to that person if you're still feeling really nervous about looking at the audience. And if you don't see anybody like that, if all you're seeing is people that are looking intimidating or looking bored or, looking angry, people can have facial expressions for all kinds of different reasons. You might just look over the tops of everybody's heads in the audience. This is face-to-face if you're in a room. So I think there's ways to start. I think if you know you have a particular aversion to looking at people, there's techniques like that you can do. You can also visualize somebody sitting in the audience that you love to speak to, and you imagine that person's there.
Oh, this is a good point.
Yeah. Imagine them sitting and smiling in the audience going, oh yeah, you're doing great. Great job. Good point. Things like that.
You could ask a friend to be your smiling buddy.
Yeah.
In the audience.
Good idea.
Yeah, and even further, you can ask a friend to ask you a question to start off the feedback. Ask you a question you know the answer to. That can always be a really helpful thing. Give you confidence to have a friend straight after you finish your presentation and they say, are there any questions from the floor? And your friend would say, yes, I was wondering about this aspect of your presentation. And you're like, oh, thanks for that. I'll elaborate. So again, there's little tips and techniques you can do. The other thing about eye contact, I would say, is try as much as possible to just remember that we're all human. The way we like to communicate is typically looking at the person, looking at each other to take in all that other information, to see how invested this person is in their message, why it's important to them. Just about sharing.
Thank you.
I recall when a client asked if he could give me feedback on my presentation to the school board. And I was like, oh, okay. And he said, if you could make better eye contact and project your voice, everything that you would have said would have had more conviction to it. Wow. And I did that the next time. And I treated myself. I bought a piece of jewelry afterwards because I felt so pleased with myself. And it made such a difference to the message and to my sense of reward about doing a good job. So, finding a cue to help you actually experience that satisfaction is really worth the effort, guys.
Yes. Yes, well done. The other thing I'd say too is, yes, we love those great moments where we know we've nailed a presentation. But we'll often learn more from the presentations that haven't gone well. You'll remember them, you'll learn them, you'll learn from them. And if you have the ability to share them with your friends and colleagues, then that's really valuable information. Okay, so that's really the conclusion of my lecture. I just wanted to wrap up with distill the message, make sure you know what you want to say, make it concise, use those methods that we had at the beginning to just generate content and then streamline down what, why, and how. We tell the story by structuring our information for the moment for the audience and for a way that suits us. And then we own the stage in a way that helps us mitigate any nerves and thoughts we might have, helps us tap into how we would normally speak if we were engaged and excited about a topic to people that we know and like. So that can just help us build our own style of communication and become really articulate and convincing in our work, both in our work and at uni. And I'd love for you to stay in touch with me. I have a podcast where I interview great communicators in the industry, really helpful tips, my website and Insta. But thank you so much for your time this morning. I really liked seeing you all, and thank you for your great questions. Yeah.